There are over 6 billion people on the planet, behaving distinctly different in thought, action, and emotion. What causes us to feel the way we feel? Why do some find strength, faith, and confidence, while others encounter frustration, fear, and disappointment? The behavior of the entire human race abides by one law. It governs the way we think, act, and feel. It is the driving force behind all of man's greatest achievements, and it is the cause of man's bitter tragedies. There is a reason why we do what we do. All human behavior is governed by what makes one feel important. This is the law of importance. There is a desire, a fundamental desire, which has moved men and women to sail vast waters, scale mountaintops, and walk great distances to develop cities, cultures, religions, towns, and entire civilizations. We all have this desire, both young and old, bound and free. You will find it in every person, regardless of their background, their race, sex, or religion. It is the desire to feel important.
Dr. John Dewey states that the deepest urge in human nature is the desire to be important. This desire of importance makes us do what we do. This desire to feel important makes us want to wear the latest fashions, drive the newest cars, influences what we read and watch, and even where we live.
Dr. David Schwartz said that the need to be important is man's strongest, most compelling non-biological hunger. So just like we need food and we need water, we need to feel important.
It is this need to feel important that caused the Egyptians to build pyramids and why pharaohs wanted to be buried with their treasures. It is why kings built castles of distinction and surrounded themselves with the finest goods. Their desire to feel important drove them to conquer the world. Had our ancestors not had this desire to feel important, they would not have been driven to make discoveries and innovations. It is what led a partially deaf elementary student to drop out of school and pursue his own feeling of importance. Thomas Edison later became one of the greatest inventors of all time.
It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
When we understood the law of gravity, we were able to put a man on the moon.
There are natural laws in the universe, and when we understand those laws, when we understand the principles that govern those laws, then we can affect change and use that information, that knowledge, to benefit humanity.
The universe may look chaotic, from lightning storms to tornadoes, from earthquakes to meteor showers. But in reality, it is flowing in an organized manner, governed by natural laws. We see the same in human behavior. What looks like chaos is actually governed by the law of importance.
Looking at the law of importance, you realize that there are at least five things that make us feel important. Now, these things have nothing to do with our ego. They have nothing to do with, you know, being better than somebody or anything like that.
It's really about what makes you feel full, what makes you feel excited, what fires you up every day.
The best thing about what makes you feel important is it has nothing to do with ego or pride or anything else like that. It's all about you. And when we have this conversation, most people like to get hung up on that word important because it has negative connotations. But instead of looking at it that way, you have to look at it another way. It's not about being selfish. It's about being self-aware.
The way you discover what makes you feel important is think back to a time when you were on top of the world. Everyone has good days, everyone has bad days. Think back to a time of that. Why were you at that high? What made you feel important at that moment?
What makes you feel important can be something as simple as spending time with your family. Or perhaps your faith makes you feel important. It could be a feeling of freedom or independence. It could come in times when we are receiving recognition, acceptance, or validation from people. Whatever the activity, if it makes you feel on top of the world, this is where you will discover what makes you feel important.
There's something so simple. It's a question. And this question is, what makes you feel important? By answering that simple question, you're going to have at least five things that make you feel important.
When you discover the five things that make you feel important, these are referred to as the five I's. The I stands for importance.
Our I's come from two extremes in life. On one side, we have the drama, and then on the other side, we have the trauma. The drama, or the dramatic times in our life, are the times we absolutely love. You know, it's where we are in what I call the point of paradise, where we say, you know what, this is the way I always want it to be. We want it to be like this as many times as possible. Things like when we get married, or when we're in love, or perhaps we get a promotion, or maybe we took that last second shot at the end of the game, and it goes in, and all of a sudden we feel like a hero.
Now the trauma, that's the exact opposite, you know? That's losing the job at work, getting the pink slip in your locker, or getting picked on when you're a kid.
Maybe it's a time where you try something and you fail. Whatever that thing is, that thing that makes you say, I don't want to experience this thing anymore in my life, that's the trauma. And that's what creates that I that says, this thing will not be a part of my life again.
So we get our eyes from looking back on those experiences that define us. They can be from when we're back in third grade, from when we were in college, from when we ran a marathon. It can be any moment in your life where you had a really just powerful positive or powerful negative experience.
And these are the high ends of the spectrum, something just incredibly great and something incredibly negative. These are the things that really lead to the development of your eyes.
Once you have developed a new eye from a dramatic or traumatic experience, your life takes an unexpected change. We never know which experiences we have that will become our defining moments, but we all have them. This was the case for Dick Hoyt and his quadriplegic son, Rick.
They did all the tests on Rick, and the tests come back and they're very negative, and the doctor said, forget Rick, put Rick away, put him in an institution. He's gonna be nothing but a vegetable for the rest of his life. And that we really didn't know, you know, what was Rick was going to be able to do and what he wasn't going to be able to do. And either the doctors, they couldn't tell you. But when you looked at Rick and you talked to him and made movement, you could see that he was paying attention to everything. And especially when he started getting older, when you talked to him, you know, he'd look right at you. And to me, he was listening and taking everything in that you were talking about. So we wanted to get a computer built so that Rick could use it in order to communicate. We went to Tufts University and we met some engineers there, and they built what they called the TIC, the Tufts Interactive Communicator. And we lived in North Reading, Massachusetts at the time, and the engineers were coming to our house and everybody was betting what are the first words Rick is ever gonna say. And that's his mom saying it's gonna be hi mom, and me the dad saying it's gonna be hi dad. And the engineers are saying, no, he's going to thank us for building this communicator. And so Rick, the very first, the Boston Bruins were going for the Stanley Cup. And the very first words Rick ever said was, go Bruins. So we knew right then and there that he was paying attention and he knew everything that was going on. And he really enjoyed being involved in sports. So he used to take Rick to some of the basketball games. Well, at one of the basketball games, they made an announcement that one of the lacrosse players from the college had been in an automobile accident, and he was paralyzed from the waist down. So they're going to have this charity road race to try to help raise some money to help him pay his medical bills. And Rick came home with his computer that night from the basketball game. He told me all about it. He said, "Dad, I have to do something for him. I have to let him know that life goes on even though you are paralyzed." He says, "I want to run in the race." Well, at the time, I was 40 years old and I was not a runner. I used to run 3 times a week, maybe a mile each time, just to try to keep my weight down. And that's all we had was a Mulholland wheelchair, which was prescription made, form fitted to Rick's body. And we had a hard time pushing in it, never mind running in it. But we went down to the race. It was a 5-mile race, and they gave us the number 00. And the gun went off, and Rick and I went off with all the other runners. Well, everybody thought Rick and I would go to the corner and turn around and come back. Well, we didn't. We finished the whole 5 miles, coming in next to last, but not last. When we came across the finish line, the gym teacher's wife took a picture of Rick, and it's the biggest smile you ever saw in your life. We got home that night, Rick wrote on his computer, "Dad, when I'm running, it feels like my disability disappears." So that was a very powerful message to me.
The experience of Rick telling his dad that he didn't feel disabled when they were running was dramatic enough for Dick to create an eye of competing with his son. What started with a simple fundraiser has developed into a racing career driving what is now known as Team Hoyt. Together, they have competed in over 950 races. They have been recognized for their vast achievements and have competed in the Boston Marathon for 25 consecutive years. But their desire to compete did not stop there.
We started running a 5-mile race, and what's the ultimate? To run the Boston Marathon. So now here we are running in triathlons. What's the ultimate in triathlons? The Ironman triathlon in Hawaii. Is 42 years old. That kid that they wanted to put in an institution, you know, he's graduated from public high school, he's graduated from Boston College, he's competed in 950 athletic events all over the world, he does speaking engagements all over the world, and people look at him and say, "Wow, look what he's done with his life."
I may be disabled, but I live a very fulfilling life.
He is a fighter. He'll never quit, he never gives up. And he's always going to be moving forward. And the inspiration is just so great. And we have this special bond that's built between Rick and I that there isn't anything that we can't do together.
Trauma, or the negative experiences in our lives, is the other factor that shapes what makes us feel important. Like drama, trauma can mold our lives due to its emotional impact. We feel trauma through things such as hardship, tragedy, suffering, distress, and poverty. The development of our eyes creates our emotional fingerprint. This unique and custom programming dictates our emotional highs and lows. Simply put, our eyes are why we have good days and bad days.
We all have times of ups and downs, but now that we understand the law of importance, we can understand why we have those.
Whenever you're having two or more of your eyes being met, this is whenever you're having your ups. Whenever we're having two or more of our eyes that are being offended, this is when you have your downs.
Have you ever had one of those days where you're just so excited and you can't even sleep that night because it was such a tremendous day? If you look back at what happened, at least two of your eyes were being met simultaneously. Now, on the other hand, if you've had one of those days where you come home and you're maybe a little bit snappy and you're just grouchy and you just can't wait for that day to get over, it's because at least two of your eyes were being offended.
Think about it in your life. Any time that you've ever had that down in the dumps feeling, I guarantee you two or more of your eyes are being offended.
Well, how do you change this and how do you affect this? The only way that you can do it is if you can identify those eyes. So you really have to know what those eyes are and then be able to go out and meet those eyes, and you'll have the good days. And if you can go out and try not to offend those eyes, then you won't have those down days.
It is an incredible feeling when our eyes are being met. Naturally, we want to continue this feeling. Therefore, it is human nature to defend or support what makes us feel important.
Subconsciously or consciously, we'll do anything within our belief system to defend or support our eyes. So the conversations we have, the way that we talk about our kids, the way that we run our business, how we dress, it's always whether or not it's in alignment with our eyes.
People go to any length within their belief system to make sure that their eyes are being met. Just look at society today. We have people who are doing things they don't like to do, working jobs they absolutely hate, spending money they don't have, trying to impress people they don't like. And they do all that just to make sure that their eyes are being met. They're willing to pay any price. But then on the other side, we also have people who come out of situations that are absolutely miserable, and they make it to the top of society. It doesn't matter where they start, they're all focused on where they're going to finish. They have dreams and destiny. They have the audacity to believe that they still can make it, and they're willing to pay any price to make sure that that eye is being met.
Each of us will defend and support our eyes in different ways. That is what makes us unique. This uniqueness is what drives some to do what others may consider to be extreme.
The first time I skydived was in 1992. Real close high school buddy of mine, they called me up. They said, hey man, we're gonna go jump out of planes. I remember being in that plane, getting sweaty palms, you know, getting pretty nervous, kind of thinking, gosh, I don't know. And right when that door opens, that cold air rushes in and, woo, man, you feel alive. I mean, that's feeling alive right there. One group goes out in front of me, and the most amazing thing was they were there, and then they weren't. Right? It's like, you're like, oh my gosh, are they gonna live? Well, let's hope so, because I'm next. Then I went out, and I remember being out in free fall. I can still remember it. I was looking down at the ground, and I think I was screaming the whole time. Ah, yeah! Right then and there, I knew that that was something I was gonna do for a long time. I knew this is what I wanted to do and nothing else mattered. This is what made me feel important. And then it just so happened that my apartment catches on fire. I come in one night and it must have been one of the most depressing things I'd ever seen in my life. Everything that, you know, you accumulate over your life, it just charred. A couple days later, me and my buddy packed up some bags and we were off to Arizona. So we skydived and we did it for 20 days. We did almost 300 jumps in those 20 days. By doing all those jumps, we came up with this new concept where we were learning about how to fly on our feet and on our heads and what is now known as free flying. credit card companies started creeping in. They were getting us the calls. They were wanting their money. I really didn't have much of an address to send the bills to, so those probably weren't getting paid either.
I'm having way too much fun. Keeps getting better. It feels so good. Makes me want some more. Having way too much fun. Never ever wanna stop. It's only just begun. This is way too much fun.
Consciously, when you do what makes you feel important, then there's nothing you can't accomplish. And that was true for me in that when me and my teammate put all our energy into skydiving, and that's all we were gonna do, we didn't know what the result was gonna be, but we knew we put all our passion and our heart into it. Doors just started opening up. We were picking up sponsorships, we started doing events, we started traveling the world. What's funny is that I always wanted to get on TV or be in a film or do some more theater. And before we knew it, we were getting calls from Hollywood. The door just opened up there. There I was doing stunts and flying canopies and doing skydiving in Goldmember, Austin Powers 3. So things started falling into place. And one time I'm in the Bahamas. I just finished a skydiving demo. I'm going flying back, I'm at the airport, and I look up on the TV and there's CNN, and my buddy, he's getting arrested, right? He's on the Empire State Building, he's getting arrested for trying to jump off the thing. Now this is the guy that was gonna host the show that I was gonna do the stunt for. But then boom, I'm thinking, wait a minute, they're gonna need a host, that's me. I call them, I get on the phone and I'm just saying to them, hey, you know, I hear, you know, the host got arrested, you know, and they're like, yeah, it's bad, he's probably gonna get fired, this is really bad. And I just said, hey, if you need a host, I'm your man. Right? And they were like, oh, really? I'm like, oh, yeah, I'm your man. They're like, well, you got a demo reel? I had no demo reel, right? I'm thinking, oh, yeah, of course I got a demo reel. When do you need it? You know, and they're like, oh, well, I don't know. You want to try to send it in tomorrow? I'm like, sure, I'll do that right away. No problem. Talk to you then. Click. I'm just like, call my buddy. I'm like, hey, come meet me at the skydiving center. We need to shoot a demo reel right now. So that same day, I was out there. We're shooting. I'm just talking, blah, 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 blah. Stuff. Today, what we're going to do, we're going to watch Eli Thompson, myself, go jump on a blimp, get out of a plane, land on 4 o'clock in the morning the next day, I had a demo reel done. They, before I knew it, they called me back. They said, we love the demo reel. We want to know if you can do a screen test tomorrow. And then from there on, I mean, from the time that I made that call about being host, 2 weeks later, I had the job and I was in Hawaii shooting my first show.
The stunts you're about to see are done by highly trained professionals. If you tried them yourself, you could be seriously injured or killed. So please, do us a favor. Enjoy the show, but don't try this at home.
We shot for over a year. We finished with 30 episodes. And towards the end of the shooting, I realized that I wanted a little bit more creative control. So I started looking into executive producing. Right now, I have about 3 projects that are getting off the ground. I finished with a book. I got a book out. I've been working a lot with the Red Bull Air Force, where we're skydiving, doing demonstration jumps. The crowds are getting bigger. The events are getting bigger. Looking back, I mean, I wouldn't have been able to do this all without following what made me feel important. That is what opened the door to all the success I've had.
Since we are all constantly seeking to meet our feeling of importance, and we will do anything within our belief system to do so, why is it that some can find happiness on a daily basis, while others ride an emotional roller coaster of ups and downs? Don't we all have an equal opportunity each day to meet our I's? Therein lies the key to the law of importance and the reason for all our happiness and misery. An I by itself is neither good or bad. How it seeks validation is what is good or bad. Our I's get met one of two ways. It can be met internally or externally. When an I is met internally, it is because of something you controlled. When your I's are getting met externally, it is by other people or situations outside your control.
Really, our I's are only validated one of two ways. They're either validated internally or they're validated externally. When we validate our I's internally is whenever we have that confidence and we have that control. We're not looking to other people to validate our I's.
But when you are being external, you're oftentimes very negative, angry, frustrated, depressed, comparing yourself either to other people or maybe even to your own past. There's some level of disappointment.
Our I's are always seeking validation, but so often it's an external validation. What is someone else thinking? How do I look in this situation? Am I good enough? Am I smart enough? Am I gonna be okay? Is this embarrassing? Is this good? Is this bad? What are they thinking? What are they saying? And it's like insanity. It's insanity. And it brings about so much misery and ultimately has people forget who they even are because they're not worried about what makes them feel important. They're worried about if other people think that they're important.
It's that when-then formula to living. When I get this, then I'll feel this. When I get skinny, then I'll get the guy. When I get smarter, then I'll get hired. When I get loved, then I'll feel lovable. It's like you're never, ever there because you're always thinking there is far away from you. So you're living this external life. Oh, if I get that car. If it's this incessant, constant chase. You have no control over your own happiness. You're waiting for it. And you know, the joke is it'll never come.
Just like the greyhound, chasing his prize and never getting it. So are we when we seek validation from others. We will run and run, but we will never get that which we seek. The reason for this exhaustion is we cannot control the actions of others.
I see it everywhere, in magazines, newspaper, media, business, even in public, people embarrassing themselves. It's amusing for this external validation. They've almost become junkies. It's like an addiction, to where now it's at a point of exhaustion.
Due to the external pressures people feel, our world is increasingly obsessed with escaping. The obsession to use fantasy to escape leads to social disease.
Unfortunately, there are many social diseases today caused by fantasy. These include eating disorders, drugs and alcohol, gambling, and pornography. And I really believe that the reason these eating disorders and these drug addictions are so prevalent is because people are really looking for this external validation from either other people or they're not able to give it to themselves. And so they escape into this world of fantasy, this belief system that says, if I could just lose myself in my addictions, I'm gonna feel good. And it's the biggest lie they can ever tell themselves.
Throughout history, every crime, every war, and every atrocity is the result of somebody being external. But there is a better way. Our feeling of importance can be met internally without being influenced by the words or actions of others. This is simply done by relying on one's own knowledge and abilities. This is what it means to be internal.
Anytime you're internal, it means that you are in control. Anytime you're external, it means the world is in control. What would you rather have? right? Who can you dictate? Can you dictate billions of people? Or is it a lot easier just to work on one person, work within? That's what I'm talking about. You want joy in life? You want true happiness in life? Work on one person.
Most people confuse what it means to be internal, and they think that it means that it's all about me, that I'm always in my own little world, but that's not it at all. What I've learned about being internal is that the more I have, the more I have to give. So the more love I have for myself, the more love I have to give to other people. The more I'm feeling it, the more energy I have to give to other people.
I found, for me personally, I am much more confident. I am much more secure in who I am. I am much more giving and generous with my time, my energy, and those kinds of things.
The story of Mary Louise Zeller is one of finding confidence by becoming more internal. Her struggle began when her 18-month-old son fell from a two-story window and was critically injured.
I was depressed. I cried a lot. I could be driving down the road and I'd start crying. The baby held me together. I had to take care of him. Well, one Sunday morning, I was reading the newspaper and I saw an ad for Taekwondo. And it said to improve focus and concentration, of which I had none. It said to strengthen self-confidence, of which I had none. I mean, if you can't keep your own child safe, how good a mother are you? I mean, it's like my self-confidence was shattered. So, and then I was way overweight and out of shape, and it said get fit. So I said, wow, that sounds like more fun than running and weightlifting and aerobics. And so I answered the ad. And I was just going in to check it out in Master Kim in Vallejo, California. He handed me a uniform. He says, here, put this on. There's something about the way a master says, here, put this on. You go, okay. I wasn't gonna do that, but okay. And he taught me a lesson. He said, come back tomorrow. So I did. And I noticed that I felt more alive. And the more the more active I got physically, the more settled my mind got, the more settled my emotions got. The first 2 weeks, my muscles were so sore, I slept in the bathtub. Really, it was the only place I could sleep. I had to bounce down the stairs on my bottom, crawl up them. I don't know how I kept going, but it gave me a feeling of being alive again. It gave me hope. It did give me self-confidence. The ad was true. People told me I was too old. I started when I was 44. And I was too old, especially when, okay, you're gonna compete. The first time Master Kim said, I want you to come to a competition, I thought he meant the mommy things, cheerlead, drive, make sandwiches, you know? And he says, oh no, you will compete. It's the same thing, give you a uniform, put it on. I go, oh, okay, I'll compete. And I was terrified, I couldn't even get a deep breath. And I just did it anyway. And after it was over, I was like, wow! It was like being in high school again, getting on the bus, going to the basketball game. But I lost every match I fought for 2 years. You think you would just get discouraged and quit. But I finally went out there, instead of holding back, trying to stay safe. This is full contact Taekwondo. We wear protective gear in the Olympic style, but it is full contact. So I was trying to be safe. Well, you can't win trying to be safe. You can be safe trying to be safe, but you can't win. So I just got out there and I was going, I'm not losing one more time. I'm gonna win this match. That poor opponent of mine, I went after like a banshee. She was like, oh my gosh, somebody dragged this grandmother off of me. You know, so, and from then on out, I saw that I had something to do with it. Somewhere along the line, I said, I wanna go to the Olympics. I'm sure that God has a sense of humor now because to give me a desire to go to the Olympics when I'm, you know, 55 years old, that's a sense of humor. And everybody thought I was ridiculous. But you know what? I gave them a run for their money. In the South, they'll say, it's better to shoot for the moon and hit the fence than to shoot for the fence and hit the ground. So I shot for the moon. I got fourth in the 18 and over division in full contact fighting, which requires speed, strength, stamina, endurance, amazing quickness. It is a sport of quickness. You know, you really have to have a big dream to be alive. Power and passion in life live in that domain. The power of being internal is to actually be at the source of power. When I'm making a difference, I'm happy. If I can inspire you, look, you don't have to look forward to drooling in an old folks home when you get older. When I'm 80, I'm gonna be on the mat in some form or fashion, some mat. You know, like whatever your mat is, I'm gonna be on the mat playing the game. What I would like to leave you with, the one thing, is something that your coach will tell you, leave it on the mat. You know, when you go out, when you go out to give it all, and you know you gave it all, it is so rich. Leave it on the mat. So when you think you don't have anything left to give, you've got everything to give. Leave it on the mat. Leave it all. Don't leave this life without leaving it all. Just give it.
If you could do anything and you knew you would not fail, what would you do? What type of person would you become? How would you live? Where would you find success? If you truly believed, what could happen? The one thing all great men and women, past and present, have in common is the ability to think internally. This is where we all find the courage to accomplish great things. If your thoughts and actions are focused on meeting your eyes internally, you have the ability to validate yourself regardless of the actions or opinions of others.
Perception is reality. You heard it a million times. I mean, it is a truth. In all the years that I've been working, you can tell whenever a person is at a certain place in their life, it's because that is what their perception is. And most of the time, if you're external, the world is dictating to you what you are. The world is dictating what you should have and how you should look and how you should feel and the advertisement and TV. I mean, all these different things are dictating it. In order to change your reality, you have to change your perception. And the only way that you can change that perception, you have to change the perception not from whatever somebody else is saying, you have to change your internal perception. You have to perceive yourself different. You have to have that confidence. You have to internally identify what makes you feel important and go out there and seek those things. And that is how you're going to change your reality.
The path to becoming more internal begins with doing things that will change your perception. Giving gratitude is one of the most universal ways to be internal.
The most important time to go into gratitude is when you feel the least thankful, because it really starts to create the context where you see there's so much to be thankful for. One small circumstance externally happens. We might think, oh, we lost some money, it's the end of the world. But then you think, well, I've got good health. My kids are healthy. I get to spend some time with my family. We have a roof over our head. We're being fed. We can breathe. You just go on and on. All of a sudden, that becomes so small as your appreciation and your gratitude grows. It overshadows any external thing because you become so present to who you are.
To me, gratitude equals perspective. It means that no matter what's going on right now, no matter how bad things may look for you, somebody is praying to have your problems. Somebody is praying to have that thing that you cannot stand. Some people are praying to have somebody just call them, or somebody's praying to have something to do today. So for me, gratitude just means I have perspective. But I also understand that weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning, and that no matter what it is, this too will pass.
As you give gratitude and change your perspective, you will be in a better position to give back to others without expecting anything in return. The very act of selfless service is a simple way to validate your eyes from within. Upon arriving home after a long trip, Juan Man had no one at the airport to greet him. He felt lonely as he looked around and saw people embracing each other. He decided to make a difference. He did not want others to feel as lonely as he did. He went to the busiest mall in his hometown of Sydney, Australia, holding a sign that said, "Free Hugs."
I don't mind where you come from, as long as you come to me. But I don't like illusions, I can't see them clearly. I don't care, no, I wouldn't dare to fix the twist in you. You've shown me eventually what you'll do. I don't mind, I don't care, as long as you're here. Hours slide and days go by till you decide to come. And ever long you stay is all that I am. I don't mind, I don't care, as long as you're here.
Anyone can make a difference. The Free Hug campaign is now being embraced in over 67 countries. In addition to changing our perspective, the other side to living internally is doing things for yourself. In this sense, you are doing things for you, by you. If you take time daily to do things for you, by you, you will be in control of how often and when your eyes are met.
take time to play. Take time to read a book in a park. Take time to go for a walk. Take time to fly a kite. Whatever it might be, something almost, I would almost challenge you, that is foolish and what you see is childish. And watch how much joy and jubilation that you get, because for that moment, everything else melts away in your internal, because you're within the moment of truly having joy.
When you can identify what makes you feel important, and when you can learn how to validate those eyes, you can accomplish anything. You can have the success that you've always wanted to have. You can have the relationships you've always wanted to have. You can have the happiness you've always wanted to have. You can go and create the things around you and the world around you that you've always wanted to do. When you can really be more internal, and when you can really feel and understand and be able to validate those eyes, you can accomplish anything.
You have to fully participate in your own transformation, and the only way you can do that is to change the way you think, change the way you behave, change the patterns that you put in place, and start to act in the way that you want to eventually become. And then you, all of a sudden, you become that. That's how it works.
The road to becoming internal has been traveled by many. Sometimes by those who have persevered through tragedy. But because they chose to live internally, they found themselves accomplishing their greatest dreams.
We heard this horrible noise that sounded like a freight train was coming. It was smash, smash. I thought the car was going to stop. And then it didn't stop. It hit me.
It was December 19th, 1995, and an out-of-control car sideswiped the curb, blew out his tires, and he came up into the driveway and crushed me into the back of the vehicle. I just laid there on the ground, and I saw all the people in my life that I love. And I wasn't ready to say goodbye. And in that moment, I made a choice to live.
Okay, breath. There you go. It's looking good. Can you believe it?
Three years after my accident, in and out of the hospital, I had 11 reconstructive surgeries. It was a very, very difficult time.
That word stump is a really ugly, ugly word, and you shouldn't call part of your body that. And it's not my fault that it looks like this now, you know, but it's still my leg.
I went through prosthetic rehabilitation, trying to walk again.
You know, everyone says, well, Stephanie, I didn't love you for your legs, and it's just really hard.
All those surgeries and all those hours and days and months spent in the hospital gave me a lot of time looking out the window and saying, when I get out of here, I'm gonna feed my soul. I don't know what the food's gonna be, but I'm gonna feast. And it came to me very simply. I was in Sundance, and I had my first skiing lesson, and I was given a questionnaire when I arrived. And one of the questions on there was, what are your goals in skiing? I can be a bit of a smart aleck sometimes, and so just right away I said, oh, win a gold medal. And Marcel, the head coach, looked at my form and he said, make your goals specific. I knew exactly what he was talking about. Those athletes that had inspired me, the Paralympic athletes, it was a Paralympic gold medal. That inspired me. So I get in the monoski and I have the outriggers on and I'm just trying to stay upright and not fall face first into the snow. And, you know, okay, I can barely move, but what do we do? And he said, well, see the lift, the chairlift up the hill? I want you to push up there to the chairlift. And I said, okay, great, you know, whatever it takes. We gotta get to the chairlift. I mean, we gotta go up to come down, so let's do it. And I'm pushing with all my, and I mean, it was strenuous, it was hard work. And I got about halfway up the hill, and he said, stop. I just wanted to see if you would do it. Now, in skiing, we go downhill. There's actually another lift down the hill, so we're gonna ski down to that lift. But I wanted to see that you were physically up to the challenge.
Here we go.
300 days a year on snow was our average, and we traveled far and wide. We're platinum members on Delta Sky Mile. My love for skiing just grew beyond anything that I could imagine. That I could be on snow, I wanted to be on snow. We doggedly went after this goal of making the US Paralympic team and winning a Paralympic gold medal. And I was on my way. There was no greater connecting to the internal, connecting to all my eyes, than that opportunity. Going into the Paralympic Games in 2006, we'd had this incredible, strenuous World Cup season. But I knew I was prepared physically, I felt great. Mentally, I was sharp, I was strong, I was focused, I knew what I wanted to do. And spiritually, I had the tools to go internal that would keep me present in those strenuous moments of the world stage and 5,000 cheering fans, and not going for the ego's sake, but going internal and for my own connected to higher self's sake, winning. It was snowy, it was bad weather, no one was looking forward to it. Here it was, all on the line. And I made the commitment, I made the choice to go internal and focus my energy to, not to winning, but to giving my best self, to being in gratitude. There I was in the start, and it was my turn to shine. And I just said, okay, let's go.
Stephanie Victor skiing with a fractured wrist from an earlier crash during qualifying. This is her chance to go for the gold, having taken bronze in Salt Lake City at the 2002 Games. The crowd is really getting into it here now. Coming down to the final turns, it's going to be close. What an emotional run for Stephanie. Is she going to make it? Oh, what an incredible run!
Wow!
Be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride. Don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. And when you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. But when you dream, dream big. And when you laugh, be sure to laugh out loud, cause it will carry all your cares away. And when you see, see the beauty all around and in yourself, and it will help you feel okay. And when you pray and pray for strength to help you carry on, and when the troubles come your way.
I felt the most crippled, the most disconnected, trying to seek validation externally. The only way I've been able to deal with losing my legs is by going internally and experiencing, feeling, knowing who I am, my wholeness. And that has nothing to do with my legs.
And when you pray, pray for strength to help you carry on, and when the troubles come your way. And when you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. Cause when you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.
Do you realize that you have a choice to live externally or internally? Every single morning when you wake up, you can make a choice that I want to live internally or I want to live externally. And if you don't make the choice, guess what? The external environment will make it for you. When you realize, do you understand that you have the right to be happy? It's your God-given right to be happy. But here's where people are mistaken. They think they're entitled to it. You're entitled to nothing. Understand, you can have everything, but you must go get it.
Every day, people around the world are choosing to live internally. They are reaching their goals and making a better life for themselves. Your dreams and passions are found in following what makes you feel important.
What if you made one great decision? One positive decision to become internal today, so that you were able to live the life that you desire, would that not positively affect your future? It absolutely would.
You have a choice in this moment because you are a powerful person internally. Are you willing to recognize that power?
You gotta choose to be authentic and choose to be you. You gotta live your life to the best of your ability. And the more you do those things, the happier you are and the more happiness you have to give to other people. And that's really what it's all about. You have the power, you just have to choose to use it. Freedom.